Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. Today we'll be booting a simple RISC-based computer. In theory, there's not much to it, just hook a CPU to memory and that's it. And in practice, that is indeed the case, unless that is you spend days fighting stupid mistakes and misunderstandings. This is the Vex RISC-V project, a very modular RISC-V CPU which we'll be using in its minimal configuration. The CPU has two buses, one for instructions and one for data. That may seem weird. After all, the 6502 only had one bus, through which it fetched both the instruction and the data. But it makes perfect sense if you stop to think about it for a moment. Unlike the RISC CPU, which has multiple processing components and a control unit that routes the data around, the classic RISC CPU design has a very rigid instruction handling structure. All instructions go through the same path and take the same amount of cycles. This is offset by the fact that multiple instructions are handled at once. This means that, under ideal conditions, just the instruction fetches has the potential to saturate the bus. But thinking logically about it, it is obvious that some of those instructions will also need to fetch data. If the bus can be saturated just by the instruction fetches, the only way to allow that is to have a separate data bus, which is precisely what the Vex RISC-V is doing. With the Vex RISC-V, each bus is separated into two parts, the request, called CMD, and the response, called RSP. The most obvious line the command section has is the address from which to fetch. Under the data bus, this is called payload address, and under the instruction bus, payload PC, which stands for program counter. One thing to notice is that it is possible to have cycles where no bus operation is requested at all. Under the 6502, if no memory fetch was needed, the CPU still issued a dummy, sometimes almost random, address and just ignored the response. RISC uses a different strategy. The command valid signal indicates whether the address given during this cycle should be used. If it is zero, the rest of the command should simply be ignored. This happens all the time for the data bus, where actual memory fetches are relatively rare, but it may also happen for the instruction bus. Due to various reasons, it is possible that the CPU simply isn't ready to handle another instruction fetch. When that happens, it sets the instruction bus command valid signal to low. When the command valid signal is low, we need to ignore whatever happens on the rest of the command lines.
Me fall for this? Why, the mere implication.
In addition to the command valid output signal, the CPU also has a command ready input signal. A conforming implementation is to set this to 1 to indicate to the CPU we managed to get the command and are working on carrying it out. If we set this signal to 0, the CPU will just hold the processing involved until we set it to 1 again. For the instruction bus, the address is the only command payload. The data bus has two more payload lines. One is the read-write line. It tells us whether the CPU is trying to read or to write.
Why? What did you think it meant?
The other is the data out. If this is a write operation, the CPU needs to provide the data to write. Since the data bus is 32-bit, it also needs to tell us the width of the command. It is possible it's writing the whole word, but it's also possible it's only writing one byte. The command payload size line tells us how many bytes are being written. You'd expect this line to also apply to the read. You know what? Maybe it does. What I found out, however, is that just giving the CPU the 32-bit word that's on the correct range is enough. So all I need to do for reads is return the whole 32-bit word and let the CPU pick the correct value from it.
I should point out that writing a dedicated project just to find out how the bus works was a huge help in figuring out the CPU memory interfaces.
Which brings us to the response. Just like the command, the response does not need to be ready immediately. So the CPU has another line indicating the response is ready. Strangely, it's called response ready for the data bus and response valid for the instruction bus.
I spent 2 days trying to figure this out. You spent 2 days trying to figure this out.
The response also has the actual return data, obviously, as well as an error line. With that out of the way, we can set the CPU up with actual memory.
We interrupt this broadcast to say a quick thank you to my Patreon supporters. In particular, I'd like to extend my thanks to John Banyan and Ira Abramov. Thank you, guys.
One thing to note here is that the CPU doesn't expect a response until the cycle after the command. Memory that works this way is called synchronous memory because it uses a clock to time the response. This setup allows for higher clock rates.
Thankfully, we have synchronous memory inside the FPGA itself. The block RAM module is a dual-port synchronous memory. Dual-port means it can handle two commands at the same time. This is handy as we have two buses to serve at the same time. So at this point in time, I'm using this to handle both the instruction bus and the data bus using the same memory block. Each block RAM has 36 kilobit of memory. If this number seems strange, it's because it's not a power of 2. That's because each block of RAM is meant to be used with ECC error correction. Each byte has an extra bit meant to store parity and other error detection. Since we're not using any of that, we can simply divide the memory size by 9 instead of by 8 to get the actual number. So each block RAM module has 36 kilobit of RAM, which translates to 4 kilobytes of RAM. The XE7S15 FPGA we're using has 10 block RAM modules, giving us 40 kilobytes of usable memory. For reasons I won't go into yet, I need the actual number to be a power of 2, so we're using 32 kilobytes of RAM. For what we need now, that's more than enough.
That just leaves us with loading, you know, an actual program.
I won't go into the software compilation setup. For now, suffice it to say that I can write the ops to be performed in C++. Assuming all dependencies are met, I just run make in the root of the project. The sources compile and produce a COE file describing the words in the memory. And with that, we're almost done. Just synthesize a clock for the whole thing, and we can run it. I use a 150 MHz clock. With those out of the way, we can watch our masterpiece load in the Vivado simulator. Without in any way trying to diminish the glory of the moment, I wanted to make sure it runs on the actual FPGA. Of course, there's a problem in doing that. This computer doesn't have any I/O. It is at this point that we need to make a decision about our new computer's memory layout. The CPU is currently configured to start executing code at address 0. We can make the physical memory we have appear to the CPU in pretty much any address we want. But again, for now, beginning of address space is where it'll stay. Since the CPU has 32-bit of address bus, we have 4 gigabytes of RAM to place whatever we want within. We have 32 kilobytes of usable on-FPGA memory and 256 megabytes of RAM on the board. There is plenty of slack to work with here. As such, I decided to dedicate the entire top half of the address space to I/O. We don't need 2 gigabytes of addresses for I/O, but we don't need more than 2 gigabytes of addresses for memory either. This simplifies the is it I/O logic to just checking the most significant bit of the address. So let's add a UART to the computer. Luckily, I already have a UART core I've written in order to get the Apple II's text display. Pulling that into the project should be easy enough. Looking at the UART send module, we're seeing an interface that by now seems rather familiar. In fact, connecting it to the RISC is a simple mapping. Dbus command payload data maps to the UART's data in, dbus command payload valid maps to the UART's data in ready, UART's receive ready maps to dbus command payload ready, and we're pretty much done. Of course, we also need to do address-based selection. We just assign UART send the first address in the I/O range. We can now send data over UART by simply writing bytes into the address 8000000. We need to keep in mind that the CPU's clock is running at 150 MHz, whereas the UART symbol speed is at 115 kHz, and each byte requires sending 10 symbols. So it takes the UART 13,000 CPU clock cycles to send a single byte. Looking at the simulator, we can see that the first byte goes through immediately. This makes sense as the UART starts out idle. When it's time to write the second byte, however, the UART isn't even halfway through sending the start bit. As a result, the CPU halts operation for a long time until the UART reports idle again and can accept the second byte. This is precisely what we want it to do. The only thing left to check is that this actually works on an actual board. Flash it. And we are greeted. Hello, world. How are you doing?
Well, that concludes the first episode of Building a RISC Computer. Next time, we'll try to get the CPU to use the external, much bigger DDR memory. Until then, thank you for watching. See you next time.